Yosemite has had a turbulent past. 200 million years ago, its coastal plain is shattered by volcanoes. And then, 7 million years ago, the Merced River suddenly carves a deep V-shaped Yosemite Valley. For the next 4 million years, the river runs in this narrow canyon. But then, Yosemite is radically transformed again.
About 2.5 million years ago, when our ancestors were beginning to evolve in Africa, the V-shaped valley that was here began to evolve into the present valley floor, which is flat and is bounded by these vertical sheer rock walls on its side.
It was during this second extraordinary stage of cliff formation that the most iconic rock in America formed, Half Dome. This natural wonder's unique shape has intrigued people for centuries. Its enormous granite dome is over 3 billion cubic feet in size, as large as 1,000 football stadiums. And its striking northwest face is a 2,000-foot vertical drop. In 1870, amateur geologist John Muir had a radical theory about how Half Dome and Yosemite's other vast cliffs formed. He believed that thousands of years ago, the Earth's temperature had plummeted and the valley had been filled with ice.
You know, one thing that's important to keep in mind about John Muir, he didn't come up with this idea overnight. He was trekking, hiking, walking, going up to the tops of mountains. And the entire time he was doing this, he was listening, he was seeing, he was feeling, he was touching. And so he was slowly, letter by letter, word by word, learning the language of Yosemite.
Muir knew from research in the European Alps that glaciers were capable of gouging out solid rock. As these great rivers of ice flow downhill, they press down on the canyon walls with a weight equal to 200 trucks per square yard, ripping out chunks of rock and causing the valley walls to get steeper.
In general, glaciers transform a V-shaped valley that we see as characteristic of a river into a U-shaped valley by focusing their erosion on the valley walls rather than on the valley bottom, until it has reached this U-shape, at which point it can then continue to erode as that U-shape.
Muir knew that as a glacier flows, it grinds and polishes the bedrock with rough shards of rock lodged at its base. As they melt and disappear, glaciers leave behind U-shaped valleys and distinctive scratch marks. Muir proposed that giant rivers of ice also once flowed through Yosemite Valley. He hunted high and low for evidence of glacial scratch marks and eventually found a small 20-foot square patch of rock 30 feet from the valley floor.
The granite has scratches on its surface. Each one of these scratches is associated with a rock embedded in the sole of a glacier. I can imagine Muir claiming that this is irrefutable evidence of glacial occupation of the valley floor.
But if glaciers plowed down the valley, why weren't there millions of scratch marks on the cliffs? If Muir was correct, this is a picture of what happened. 2.5 million years ago, the temperature plummets. Yosemite Valley fills to the brim with a gigantic glacier. Only the tallest mountains peak above the sea of ice. For thousands of years, the glacier grinds away at the granite walls, scratching the cliffs and undercutting a peak that will become Half Dome. When it retreats, the glacier leaves precarious slabs of overhanging rock. The unstable rock face crashes to the valley floor. Cleaving the great northwest face of Half Dome. In the same way, subsequent smaller glaciers cut away at the base of the valley for 2 million years, cleaving sheer vertical cliffs and removing all traces of glacial scratch marks. But there was still one glaringly obvious problem with Muir's theory, and archenemy geologist Josiah Whitney pounced on it. If glaciers had carved the valley, why was Yosemite uniquely box-shaped and not U-shaped like a classic glacial valley. Whitney attacked Muir's theory and stubbornly declared this square, flat-bottomed valley could only have formed if the bottom had fallen out.
Whitney hypothesized that instead of being carved by glaciers, that this was a fault-bounded valley, with the valley walls being faults down which the block in between the valley walls has dropped. In Whitney's theory, the flat valley floor would be the top of the down-dropped block.
In the quest to unravel the mystery of Yosemite's flat-bottomed canyon, scientists are investigating the valley floor.
The kind of sediment that I see in this cut bank are coarse grains, pebbles, and sand, the same kind of rocks and sediment that the present stream can carry. In contrast to that, the deposit I see at my feet is very fine grain.
Light, fine grain sediment like this is easily carried by flowing water. But when a river hits a body of still water, its energy levels slump and it dumps its load.
This is the kind of sediment that we would expect to see on the floor of a lake.
Further research has found similar strange sediments all over Yosemite. It's proof that 10,000 years ago, an ancient lake drowned this entire valley. Starting at the head of the canyon, it stretched for 5 miles through the landscape. But it was a mystery how Lake Yosemite had formed. Scientists scoured the valley looking for answers, and near the base of El Capitan, at the farthest end of the valley, they stumbled upon an insignificant-looking ridge. It's an important clue to how Lake Yosemite and the valley formed. This mound is made of an unusual collection of rocks, and it runs from one side of the valley to the other.
Given this arc of a ridge is just down from El Cap, one might expect that it could have been caused from a rock fall. But if you look around, that's not the case. Clearly, even in this local area, we have rocks that came from at least 3 different places, no doubt up the valley. This pink rock came from one portion of the valley. This gray granite came from another place. And this particular one, we can see the distinctive feldspars associated with the Cathedral Peaks granite.
This strange distribution of rocks means that the ridge could not have formed from a catastrophic rock fall. Something else, just as epic, must have created it. This is a glacial moraine, the remnants of a glacier which once filled the valley. It's the conclusive evidence Muir had hoped for. Moraines form as glacial ice rips fragments of rock from the valley walls, carries them like a conveyor belt several miles downstream, and dumps the rubble at the mouth of the glacier. Scientists realize this ridge was also key to solving the mystery of how Lake Yosemite and the flat-bottomed valley floor formed. It wasn't just a moraine, it was a giant dam. It's 2.5 million years ago, and glaciers grind through the valley. 10,000 years ago, the temperature rises and the glacier retreats. A huge moraine is dumped at the valley mouth, damming back the icy meltwater. The entire valley floods, creating an enormous Lake Yosemite. Mountain streams spill into this still water and dump ton after ton of fine sediment. The lake chokes with silt, creating Yosemite's distinctive flat-bottomed valley floor.
We know from seismic evidence collected in the 1930s that it's 2,000 feet thick. That's enough sediment to cover New York City by a foot.
And beneath this lake of sediment, they found the evidence that had always eluded Muir, a U-shaped basin, the hallmark of a classic glacial valley. It was indisputable evidence that Muir's intuitive observations and seemingly far-fetched theory were correct. And the final nail in the coffin for Whitney's theory of a cataclysmic rifting valley.